Welcome to both of you. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm so looking forward to having this opportunity to hear more about your project. Can you briefly tell us about the museum and your project?
Yeah, sure. Firstly, thank you for having us. We're all so excited to be part of all of this. So the Bay Discovery Centre is a social history museum in the heart of Glenelg, South Australia. Glenelg is on the Gulf St Vincent, so we are a coastal community. We're really, really lucky in Glenelg. Location is key to everything. And so because of where we are, we're able to tell all sorts of stories, including maritime, terrestrial, historical, and Aboriginal. And as I said, our location is key. And so one of the most important things about our location is that we're on Kaurna country.
Glenelg and Holdfast Bay is it's a very special place. It's also a place that was a campsite for our ancestors, and it's also a burial site further down at Tingston Park, where we've been able to reinter some of our ancient ones that have come home from overseas that were taken from us. So it's a very special place.
So yeah, the museum is, its location is important in that it's in Glenelg, where the first European settlers arrived in 1836, and as Lynette was talking about the Patawalunga River, that's where they came in, and that's within metres of the museum, and it was there that some of the first contact between Aboriginal people, the Kaurna people, and the colonists occurred. Mm. So the museum is within that location. The old gum tree is the site where the proclamation of South Australia happened. So though a lot of the legislation was done prior in England, it was on the 28th of December that South Australia was proclaimed a state. And so as that place where first contact happened, I think council in the last sort of more or so in the last decade has really recognised its role in trying to educate people about this history and recognising the importance of giving Kaurna a voice to be able to talk about their history too.
Then your exhibition addressed teaching this history in a unique way, I think. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Tiati Wangkanthi Kumangka is a joint exhibition. It's co-curated between Lynette and myself. So I'm the curator at the Bay Discovery Centre, and Lynette is a senior Kaurna elder. And I guess we were having a conversation one day and we just realised that the history that we've been taught through generations is not necessarily not true. It's just that there's these gaps in it, and they're pretty huge, vast gaps, and particularly pertaining to the Aboriginal history. And because of that, we're quite often taught a narrative that is just a little fraction of what the actual truth is. And until we're actually able to speak about some of these truths and to acknowledge some of these truths, the path of reconciliation between the communities, the two communities, is actually not particularly possible. And so we recognise that. Mm. And we wanted to create a space where people could recognise that what they've been taught is not necessarily wrong, but that there is much, much more to learn. And in bringing those two histories together, we have actually created the one story and what we look at as being the truth.
Because there's truth in non-Aboriginal society as well as in Aboriginal society. And it's basically we come from an oral history of culture, where everything's passed down through storytelling. And then you have to be of, certain age and time for you to receive some of the wisdom from the elders sometimes. But what we're finding out that what has happened is it's other people's truth and it's our truth and everybody needs to discuss the differences that we have in both truths and recognise that there's good truth, you know, in each side of the coin, so to speak, and, you know, but embrace the differences. It was about a relationship, like developing a relationship where we can just have the conversation with one another without feeling angry or frightened to ask the questions.
Because it's quite a confrontational topic for a lot of people, particularly when there's not an understanding, I guess, between the two communities, that it is okay to ask the questions. So we wanted to open this space where people felt comfortable enough to explore bits of it.
And how did that work when you brought these two different communities together? Was it, were there challenges? Was it, did it come across as very positive immediately, or?
It just didn't happen overnight.
No.
We've been talking to one another for sort of many years, and it's about making a decision to agree to do something and go ahead and do it.
And Lynette's referencing almost 30 years of conversation. It's been about finding the right people at the right time, and we've sort of gone through these waves. And 2019, which is when a lot of this happened, it was just, it all just fell into place. It felt like we'd all been speaking for so long and we'd been talking for so long that it was just time to take action.
So in the exhibition then, do you present both communities' view of history, or how do you facilitate that, showing those both sides?
We've basically written the history as most Australians, most South Australians would understand it. And then underneath that, we have Tiati. Tiati means truth. And Tiati is the voice of Garnaut. No. So you've got what we think we know, what we perhaps don't know. And then as you read that as a narrative, it comes together as one story.
And that was then, and this is now, and how we're going to work together.
Yeah.
And we have the Premier of the state wanting to replicate what we've done here in Parliament House. So that tells the true history of the state. Mm. And see, a lot of students that are going through university and school and that don't know. They don't know their own history about their state, you know. And I think this is about community education. We all come from the community. We live in the community. And there needs to be a whole community education process about what has happened to the community and how the community has developed.
We are the first to do such a thing.
Yeah.
And then when you look at it at a state level, so the tier above local government, they have done nothing either. Our big museums have done nothing. So we've actually sort of tried to step into this space, and some people have told us that we've been brave, but I don't really think we have. I think we've just done it because it needs to be done. It needs to be said, and our children need to be educated. But what we're, I think, quite proud to see is that our one move has sort of caused a flow-on effect.
Generated a lot of...
Yeah, and particularly for Garnaut, who work incredibly hard across all these councils. And so there is a flow-on effect that, as Lynette said, the Premier is looking at wanting to do something in the city, and there's some other talk amongst other councils. So we're really proud of that. That's something that's definitely been an outcome that I don't know, you can hope for that kind of thing, but you don't always know it will happen. When we got our feedback from the jury for the Amaga National Award, that was something that they pointed to, which was that we'd sort of just done it all. You know, they had outlined some steps. Amaga Australia has come up with a roadmap. It's a 10-year roadmap. And it's basically how to engage with Indigenous communities, how to get them involved in the museum spaces, how to look at your collections and decolonise those spaces. And yeah, some of that feedback was that we had met all of that criteria and more. And beyond that, that we had actually done something that a lot of larger institutions in Australia are really, really struggling to do, which is to form the relationships mm-hmm. and to just do it.
Just so impressive the government has wants you to replicate this and that you're getting that much deserved attention for this project and for the
we
way that you approach it.
We have a little booklet that we give the kids, and the last question in the booklet, when children come in, something I don't want them to leave overloaded. I really like them to leave maybe with just one thing in their head. And my last question in that booklet is, have you ever had anything taken away from you, perhaps from a sibling or, you know, from a friend? And how did that make you feel? But I also swap that question around and I say, have you ever taken anything from somebody? How did you feel when you did that? Or how did that other person feel? And they can write about it or they can do a little drawing or something. And it's through that very simple question that actually has, you know, very little to do with the history part side of it, that they leave with an understanding of how it must have felt for Aboriginal people mm. in 1836 and how it continues to feel.
Yeah, the children get it.
Yeah. You
know, they actually get it.
Yeah. And that's like one of the questions that you have on your list is about, was it about challenges?
Yeah.
And I don't actually think in the process of writing Tiati that Lynette and I had many challenges, because the challenge is in the relationship. And if you have that relationship, it's pretty smooth sailing. Mm. But for me as a curator, the challenge has been, since the exhibition has been opened, mainly dealing with adults and the differing opinions. And Australia very much is a deeply racist country still, whether we like to admit it or not. And a lot of the opinions I hear are very deeply set in things people learned as children and have carried with them through their adult lives. So my biggest challenge has been watching these adults be challenged by the topics and by the content. I'd say 60% of the time they leave pondering and often change their opinions or realise that they didn't know what they needed to know to actually form an educated opinion. But 40% of the time there is a group that is still very much rooted in their beliefs. And working with those people and trying to figure out how to engage them in such a way that they leave with something positive that they then think about, whether they think about that for a year or whether they think about that for the next decade of their life. Perhaps it'll just slightly switch their opinion. And that's a huge goal for us, but it nonetheless has been a challenge. And making sure that my volunteers are confident enough to speak to some of these topics and to deal with some of those people has also been a challenge. But they're kind of welcomed challenges, if you understand what I'm saying.
Completely do. Yeah. You're creating dialogue and a place to start building empathy and a place to have discussion. Which is really exciting to see happening there around this really important subject.
And it's just to point out, it is for our community, but it's also very much for the Kaurna community and the Aboriginal community, the wider Aboriginal community in South Australia. So it has a very vast audience. Mm. We see lots and lots of different people and groups coming through, which is also really exciting because it means that we've achieved what we set out to do.
Well, I love that you're starting to build a bridge between these communities, and hopefully this can continue to grow and move forward with other projects that you may do or around the country. So my final question for you two is, what advice or guidance would you give to other museums, either in Australia or in other countries who are really looking at this repatriation issue and trying to give voice to communities that have not had their voices shared to really show the truth about our history?
I think there's probably two sides to that story, probably from Lynette's perspective and my perspective. From my perspective as a museum professional and from a council perspective, relationships. You will get nowhere if you do not have relationships. And when I say relationships, I also mean time. Time for relationships to grow and for trust to be built and understanding. Creating an exhibition like this doesn't just come at the drop of a hat. You need to have that solid foundation in order to move forward. We moved forward quite quickly in the end. Tiati actually came to be in about 6 months. It was written, designed and put on the wall in 6 months with 30 years of history behind it. So though for us it was quick, time and relationships. And then my final piece of advice is to just do it, to stop being worried about the fallout, to stop
Political correctness.
The political correctness and the concern over what comes of your collection if you maybe admit that parts of it were taken or stolen and all of those issues. Don't get too bogged up in the complexity of all that. It is a spider web. You do have to untangle it, not denying that. But in the end, if you focus too strongly on all of those things, you're not going to get very far. At some point, you do have to just bite the bullet, be brave, and just do it. That's my advice.
Yeah, it needs a bit of just a courage or a conviction to say, well, you know, make up your mind and we're going to do something. Or, you know, it could be as easy as talking like that over a cup of coffee and engaging. I'd say if you got seven people on side, the max, that are interested, that are in the area, and like I say, it's like having those ducks lined up within the council, because you have to look at what you've got and you have to work with what you got, right? But you have to work with those people to get the best outcome that everybody's looking for. And I think sometimes when you talk to people, you know, like lots of times it's not about apportioning blame or, you know, wanting everybody to bow and scrape in front of you and say you're sorry. All right, well, Rudd said that in 2008 and, like, we've moved
on. That's our former Prime Minister.
We've moved on from that. But some people have to come to terms with the reality of what has actually happened. And then we can move forward.
I couldn't agree with you more. Thank you both for such a wonderful conversation and for sharing your amazing journey with all of us. And be safe.
You too.
Natalia.
Thank you. Natalia.